With me this morning in the studio from Open Orphan, I'm joined by Cathal Friel and from hVIVO, Andrew Catchpole. Good morning to you both. Nice to
good
see
morning.
You.
Andrew, good morning.
Cathal, firstly, significant RNS this morning on Flu V from hVIVO. Just give us a quick snapshot of what that's about.
Yeah, Andrew, as you know, Open Orphan acquired hVIVO earlier this year, at the end of January. And when we acquired it, we said it was a sleeping giant. And we also said within hVIVO there was a lottery ticket. Some tickets come good, some don't. But Flu V, we believe, is our lottery ticket. And this morning we announced that Flu V had stunning results in phase two, but we're making really clear we're a profitable services company. There's an awful lot of money being spent in this Flu V by the prior management, by the prior shareholders. And going forward from today, and all expense of developing this Flu V will be done from out-licensing. And so I want shareholders to reassure we're not suddenly going off to be a discovery company. That's high risk, high reward. But we did say it is a sleeping giant. Look at the news flow the last couple of days and watch going forward. But Flu V, timing couldn't be better. Very exciting time to have one of the world's first universal flu vaccines coming through the clinic.
And we'll return to that in a moment with a bit more detail. But yesterday, another significant announcement around the world's first human coronavirus challenge study. Tell us a bit more, Carl.
Yeah, again, not overhyping the sleeping giant, but guess what? Yesterday, Andrew and his colleagues some years ago did quite a bit of work on developing a ninth challenge study model. We already have eight. hVIVO has the world's largest collection of challenge studies. They considered developing a world's first coronavirus challenge study model. 2 years ago, the market didn't seem to be there. I think we all know there's a market there now. So yesterday we announced that we're kicking off the process. It's early days, but more importantly, we said we have early stage discussions with Chinese pharma companies who want to pay for that. So reassuring our shareholders and investors, we're not spending money developing that coronavirus challenge study model. It's very exciting. We've had CBS, Wall Street Journal, everybody on the phone, looking for interviews with Andrew yesterday, because we're the world's force. But it's, again, that's why I said hVIVO, when we acquired it, it is a sleeping giant. It had all these wonderful things going on. 2 years ago, nobody was interested in a universal flu vaccine. Guess what? I think that has changed. 2 years ago, there was no market for a coronavirus challenge study model. That's certainly changed. But I'm reassuring, it will take money to a couple of million to develop the challenge study model. It will take money to develop the commercialization of a universal flu vaccine. But we're funding that through third parties. It's not coming from Open Orphan shareholders. Mm. But all the upside, I call it a lottery ticket, will derive to us.
And Andrew, you and I will be speaking about that study in a moment, but Cathal, 3 out of 3, and this contract that you announced on Friday, tell us who this is with?
Yes, we can't say who it is. Andrew knows. Very exciting European, right. EU-based biotech pharmaceutical company, very large one. But what we said there again, when we acquired hVIVO, we said it was loss-making, we'd turn around. How do you turn around? You reduce overheads, but you must get revenue. Friday's announcement was 3.2 million sterling. In the immediate term, the coming months, and even more exciting, that's a pilot challenge study of an RSV vaccine. The follow-on will be a 7 million, provided that goes well, later this year, a 7 million pivotal study. So there is one deal, I call one little deal. We did say hVIVO had 80 million in the pipeline, so to prove to the market we were right, we know there's a deal, 3.2 upfront, potentially 10 within the coming year. And out of that pipeline, there's more where that comes. I think I've set a challenge for Andrew, the team and everybody. We want to be announcing these deals on fairly regular succession. So the turning hVIVO, Open Orphan around, cutbacks, yes, they're sore and painful, get revenue. And now we're kind of tickling the sleeping giant. It's waking up and wow, it's a pretty exciting place. I think Andrew has the Wall Street Journal on to him, CBS News, Good Morning Britain. We're being careful. We're not going to be all over the news. We've got to now deliver. We have 18 volunteers came into our clinic this morning. The clinic is busy. We can't have camera crews in there. I know that's to all our media friends who want to come in. There's ethics. People are helping us. But yes, we've had an overwhelming response to our flucamp.com from a Sunday Times article that we have so many volunteers. Mm-hmm. Human nature at its best. People wanting to help us. But yeah, it's sometimes, I quoted somebody else, Margaret Thatcher used to say, the harder we work, the luckier we get. So I think Andrew and his team, and everybody in hVIVO, and everybody in Venn, the deal on Friday, we couldn't have announced without our colleagues in Breda, with our colleagues in Paris. This was a combination of the data, statics, stats, medical writing coming from our Venn colleagues in Paris and Breda, and the challenge study coming from Andrew's colleagues in London. So this is proven to the world. I know, the last thing I'd say, we have a couple of legacy hVIVO institutional shareholders. Hi guys, you're selling shares yesterday, today, and the day before. We just wish they wouldn't. They would just bear with us for 2-3 months, and those legacy household name institutions might get a lot more money if they wait at the end of the summer. It's their prerogative to sell, but we just think they should give us the benefit of the doubt.
Any ideas why?
I think it's just a post-Woodford era. People are looking for liquidity. We had a call yesterday morning at 12 o'clock. Reuters were going to run an article at 12:05. Open Orphan was the only share in the whole of Europe that was green, that was positive, that was going up. And guess what? One of our legacy shareholders decided, wow, just before we ran the story, dumped shares. We booked the market yesterday. We're going well today. But until we hopefully either those two legacy shareholders trade out, or maybe we might try and talk to them and say, listen, guys, would you mind bearing with us for 2-3 months? Your own shareholders would do better to bear with us. Give us a chance to prove it. I know when I came into you in January, I said we're going to do a lot of things, but hey, the last 3-4 weeks, I think we've got well done. So I just wish our two legacy hVIVO institutions would give Andrew, the hVIVO, the Venn team, the benefit of the doubt for 2-3 months, and they would maybe selling out for a substantial higher. But if they don't, we'll probably try and find a solution and maybe try and buy them out so that our shareholders can benefit the fabulous work the team has put in place.
Andrew, tell me a bit more then about your, just briefly, about your own background. You're an expert in flu virus replication from Oxford University.
That's right. I did my undergraduate at Warwick and then did my postgraduate at Oxford University on flu replication.
Right, so this coronavirus challenge model, this is essentially from what Cathal was saying, this is a revival of a study which was backburned a couple of years ago,
right.
Is it?
So hVIVO it totally specialises in doing human viral challenge models. And as Cathal mentioned, we've got numerous models. And this was one virus we identified actually a number of years ago would be very good to do and very useful. Actually, what people don't realise is coronaviruses have been with us many, many decades. And actually are responsible for 20%, maybe 15 to 20% of the cold viruses. So out of every year when people get colds, 15 to 20% of those are already caused by a coronavirus. So coronavirus have been with us a long time. What's different about this new one, it's a new strain, we have less immunity to it. So what we're doing is we're now looking at using one of those more common coronaviruses and putting that into the challenge model. So it'll make it totally safe. It will give fiery, sort of mild flu-like symptoms, but it won't have the morbidity associated with this COVID-19.
And so you're looking at two strains.
So we're at the moment comparing a number of different strains. All of the strains we're comparing are from these more common seasonal coronaviruses that are known to cause more flu-like mild symptoms.
Forgive the basic question, but given the climate at the moment, people are getting the coronavirus and then within the space of a few weeks recovering. Why the need for a challenge study? I mean, what are you going to learn in particular from close watch of them?
Well, you raised two good points there. So one thing you can do with challenge models is learn a lot about the viruses. We can study the viruses with this and on more an academic exercise, or looking at biomarkers and proteins and part of the immune system that's triggered. But actually, our main aim for developing this is really to give people and our customers the tools to test their products against this. So very similar to what we've done with RSV and flu, very successfully. We've seen those models adopted quite successfully for big biotech, small biotech, and large pharma. They're testing their products using the challenge models. The reasons why they do that is because it's very much more efficient, very time sensitive, and very cost effective to do this. So rather than going to the field where they'd need many thousands of subjects, of all of which have different comorbidities, what we do is essentially have a cleaned up, very safe, very controlled version in our containment facilities. So they can get answers very, very quickly, and actually speed for this outbreak is going to be very important. So if they can use a challenge model and look at their antiviral drugs or potentially their vaccines and know straight away whether it's working or not within a matter of months, that will help them then fast track the right drugs to go forward through to phase 3.
And how long will you be watching them for?
So they will be in our unit for up to 2 weeks, yeah.
And how many patients?
So it will depend very much on the product, but typically these challenge studies are 50 to 100 patients maximum, really. You can get very good clean data for an antiviral and around the 50 to 60 patients.
Yeah. Right.
They're actually human volunteers. So I use the word patients because you use the word patients. Mm. But actually, we should remember these are volunteers. They're actually healthy volunteers. They're not coming to us sick. We're taking these volunteers and we're giving them the virus and making them sick and then recovering them through. They will recover completely naturally on their own. What we do is test these products, and ideally the products, if they're efficacious, will then clear the virus very much quicker.
And these are other people's products?
Yes.
Are they? So right. You're essentially helping someone else come up with
yes.
a vaccine?
Yeah, so this is effectively a service tool. So we put this model in place, and then people, the biotechs or the pharmaceuticals who own these products will then come to us to test their products and get an answer very, very much quicker.
Right, so can't you essentially get a service fee?
Absolutely.
Doing this.
And that's yeah. what I'm saying, Andrew. We're going to be a very profitable services company, taking no risks. We said that's where we're going. Discovery is risky.
Yeah. And Andrew, I'll let you take a sip. Yeah. But the announcement this morning, the flu V data, just tell us a bit more about this and the significance.
Yeah, this is a really important product, actually, and perhaps something that's been underestimated by the community. So it's been the holy grail of flu for many, many years to have a universal flu vaccine. And what do we mean by that? Well, if we first take a step back and think about what the current flu vaccines are like, they have to be administered every single year, because what they're doing is they're targeting proteins on the outside of the virus that effectively are always being changed by the virus. So as soon as they've made the vaccine, there's been some changes, and which is why every year there's more or less agreement with the vaccine and the actual virus that's circulating. So the problem with that is, even on a good year, you've got to give the vaccine again the next year. What this Flu V product is completely different. It's targeting proteins in the virus that are conserved in all different flu strains. So they've done very good work on comparing the conserved nature of that. And what that means is it doesn't matter if there's a completely new strain entering the human population or the strains that are currently circulating are changing very slightly. This vaccine will continue working with the same efficacy. So it truly is a universal flu vaccine.
So would it have worked against the coronavirus?
No, it wouldn't have worked against a new coronavirus. That's a completely different family.
Right.
But it would work against potentially the next pandemic virus. So if you recall, in 2009, there was a new pandemic for flu because a different strain of flu entered the population and then predominated. This is a vaccine which could work against that virus and indeed any other viruses that could enter the human population.
And it's probably worth remembering, just in terms of the number who are affected by the flu, and the mortality rate yeah. is significantly larger than the coronavirus.
It is significantly larger because it's year on year, even though it's seasonal, it doesn't hit the headlines terribly often, more when there's a pandemic like in 2009. But we shouldn't forget, that's with us here to stay, flu viruses. We hope this vaccine will be something about at least tailoring the flu to be a more common cold disease. That would be ideal. If we can cure it completely, absolutely, that'd be fantastic. But all we need to do really is to stop people being hospitalized and have a vaccine that's very effective at reducing it to a common cold, and then make it more like a common cold virus.
And so what next for flu V?
So flu V, we are, as Cathal mentioned, looking for partnering and in active discussions for partnering to take to phase three. So we've had two very successful phase two studies, the one with which the publication has come out today, giving all the detailed scientific and technical data for that. And then there's another one which is coming in publication very shortly, of which we announced was also very successful in terms of hitting its primary endpoint. Well, the next stage to truly prove that this vaccine is efficacious is to take it to phase three, and that's required for licensure. The difficulty is, because this is a universal flu vaccine, there really isn't the regulatory pathway already established for this. And this is the barriers that we've come across when we've been talking to new partnering organizations to take this vaccine forward. They like the product, they're excited by the product, they think the data is fantastic, but they don't know the regulatory pathway. And that gives uncertainty and cost. So therefore, that is the point we're addressing. We have meetings set up with the EMA, we have meetings set up with the FDA, and to talk to them and show them the data and to agree what the regulatory pathway looks like. Mm. And then with a clear path forward, it makes any potential investor into this product understand the costs involved, understand what type of studies are needed to take this forward.
Why hasn't the likes of Big Pharma, Glaxo, say, come up with a vaccine yet?
It is not as straightforward as that. So, I mean, they've been working on this as well. That is a good question, of which, you know, they've been working on a number of different tools for this. So I think sometimes people can go down tunnel vision on certain routes, or they've already heavily invested into the seasonal virus vaccines. So those with seasonal vaccines, I guess there's not the true impetus, as much of an impetus to produce a universal vaccine as those without. But it is suffice to say, it's a tricky problem, of which there are a number of people working on it. This product, our FluV product, which is in partnership with Imitex, is quite unique though in its mechanism of action. I think that's really what is exciting people.
And Andrew, I might jump in there. The reason I love the pharmaceutical industry, as Andrew Scott here knows, my previous life, I was involved in the oil and gas industry. There's a huge similarity. Your question is exactly right.
Yeah.
Small pharma companies make the discoveries, as in Imutex, and big pharma commercialize them. Oil and gas, guess what? All the big discoveries in the world are made by small pioneer oil and gas companies. The big guys develop it. So that's where I was here many years ago as chairman and chief executive of Fastendog PLC. We converted the Amrit Pharmaceuticals. Amrit now is one of the most successful companies in AIM. And I'd hope to work closely with Andrew in the coming months ahead to make Open Orphan, formerly, it's part of hVIVO, was part of it, now one of the most successful pharmaceutical services companies in AIM. And that was an appropriate one. We believe it's the small companies are the pioneers, and then the big companies take the product forward. But on that, reassuring our shareholders, we are spending no money on the commercializing and working on the FluV. Our big friends are coming. And like yesterday's announcement, we said our Chinese friends are already here talking to us to commercialize the coronavirus challenge. But we've got to be careful with our cash. We're not going to splash it. And we're going to generate profits this year.
Do you reckon the outbreak of coronavirus has really changed people's attitudes towards the importance of vaccines?
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's not just vaccines, it's the importance of virology research and antiviral drugs. It's a cyclical thing. Whenever there's a new virus enters the population, everyone has an increased awareness. And you can, with all things, you can get fatigue on this. So year on year, you can understand why there's a wane in interest. But then something like this reminds us that viruses are here to stay. There's always another one around the corner. And continued research into this is critical.
And might vaccines end up becoming mandatory for certain age groups at some point?
It's not the route the UK has typically taken on mandatory, but certainly we've gone down to highly recommended. And I think there's so much public awareness for this coronavirus that I think it won't need to be mandatory. And I think there'll be a lot of endorsement and people wanting to take the vaccine.
I think, Andrew, I would have grown up and you would have grown up, but Scott or Andrew, you didn't. I got measles, I got the mumps, I got the chicken pox. Our children now will never get them because they've been vaccinated.
Yeah.
I think if we roll the clock forward 3, 4, 5 years, your question is probably right. The flu vaccine, the universal one, it'll have to be T-cell based, not the annual one. There's an impetus of 4 or 5 companies, Pfizer, Glaxo, GSK, and Sofa, what do you call them, Sofa Nova, control that market. It's an annual business, but I think governments are waking up that going forward, hopefully in years ahead, not the distant future, flu will be like measles, will be like the mumps, chickenpox is something our parents used to get at.
Cathal, just finally, when you and I first spoke on day one about Open Orphan, you had some big ambitions for the company about where you wanted the share price to be. Are you on the path?
Absolutely. Look, I'm the single biggest shareholder. I put £2.5 million. Sorry, wife, didn't tell her. Of our family money into it. But no, I've said Open Orphan, I genuinely feel, particularly in recent days, this is the best investment opportunity I've seen in my life, and I'm 55. Look, our share price would be substantially higher. I said earlier, we have a couple of legacy institutions in the post-Woodford era dumping the shares. It's unfortunate, and I say, guys, hopefully you're listening to me, if they would just give us the benefit of the doubt. We did make big statements in January, I think, look back, we said in January, hey, we've done most of them, and there's more to come. Hopefully, in the next days and weeks, we might come to an arrangement with our selling shareholders that we'll try and find them a buyer to get them off the share register. Or even better, we might manage to convince them, look, it's worth staying with us for the ride. Once they stop selling, the share price, like yesterday, I think it was one of the highest trading companies in AIM, 26 million shares traded, our share price stayed flat in a very difficult market. That's because two of our friends kept selling. No, they're under pressure. The large institutions, post-Woodford, take liquidity anywhere they find it. But maybe over the coming days and weeks, we'll get an understanding, and that will then allow our share price to take off. At the same time, I don't want people to be totally focused on share price. If Andrew, myself, the team in Venn, the team in Vision, keep delivering, as the old saying says, within a short period of time, the share price will look after itself. So we don't want to be uni-focused. We've got to deliver the goodies. And hey, presto, I go back to the start. hVIVO was a sleeping giant and were tickling and begin to waken up.
Cathal, Andrew, good to see you both. Thank you.
Andrew, it's a pleasure. Thank you very much.